Welcome back, friends. We start the course, and we would have an elaborate self-introduction, more time to know each other, each one of us, in the afternoon. But we thought it's good to start the program as such, and then there will be always time to self-introduce. So this session, we have a very eloquent speaker, Sri Sharad Joshi, another very distinguished member of Honorable Member of Parliament, Rajya Sabha. And may I request a director to introduce Sharad Joshi ji.
As Dr. Sangeeta Menon said, that we have another very illustrious speaker in the morning now. And since it's my privilege to know him also as a member of the Rajya Sabha, we have spent a lot of hours discussing the various issues in the country, particularly in the area of agriculture. I'd like to give a little formal introduction about Sri Sharad Joshi. He is a very well-known member of the parliament, very eloquent member of the parliament, speaks out his mind, as I would like to say that, emphasize this. He's the founder leader of Shekari Sangatana and All India Kisan Coordination Committee. Mr. Sharad Joshi is also a member of advisory board of the World Agricultural Forum, St. Louis, chairman World Agricultural Forum India chapter, and South Asia chapter of the World Agricultural Forum. Chairman, Standing Advisory Committee on Agriculture, 1990-91, with the rank of a Central Cabinet Minister. Member, National Integration Council, since 1990. Member, Committee on Commemoration of the 50th Anniversary of Independence. Chairman, Task Force on Agriculture, Government of India, with the rank of a Central Cabinet Minister. Representing Swatantra Bharat Paksha, the only liberal party in India, as Member of Parliament from 7th July 2004, elected unopposed by the elected members of the Maharashtra Legislative Assembly. Member, various parliamentary committees, member of governing body of the Indian Council of Agricultural Research as an elected representative of the Rajya Sabha. His educational background is MCOM from Sydenham College, Bombay, Diploma in Informatics, Medal for Banking, Korsed Ji Dada Daddy Prize for work on computation of irrigation benefits. He was a lecturer in economics and statistics at the University of Pune, IPS, Indian Postal Service, from 1958 to 68, Chief Informatics Service, International Bureau, Bern, Switzerland, agriculturalist and peasant leader, founder of Shetkari Sangatana, peasants organization in Maharashtra, and at national level of the Kisan Coordination Committee, comprising of sister organizations from 14 states. He led a number of mass agitations in Maharashtra, Karnataka, Gujarat, Punjab, Haryana, etc., for remunerative prices of onions, sugarcane, tobacco, milk, paddy, cotton, against hike in electricity tariffs, for liquidation of rural debts, and against state dumping in domestic markets. Original and persistent propounder of the postulate that the government imposed negative subsidies on the farmers as a matter of deliberate policy, which has since been vindicated. Founder of the largest organization of rural women, Shetkari Mahila Angadi, celebrated for its work for women's property rights, notably for the Lakshmi Mukti program that has conferred land titles on lakhs of rural housewives. Sri Joshi is also executive trustee, Krishi Yogachema Samshodhan Nyasa, Research Foundation on Economics of Sustainable Agriculture. Founder President and presently National President, Swatantra Bharat Paksha, 1994, devoted to abolition of license permit quota Raj and to minimal government and plural society. Chairman Shivar Limited, Chairman Burma, Bama Constructions Limited, and so on. His publications include Organization of Peasants, Thought and Practice, and several other books and articles in Marathi, translated into Hindi, Gujarati, Kannada, Telugu, Bharat Speaks Out, Bharat I View, The Women's Question, Answering Before God in English, columnist for the Times of India, Business India, Lokmat, etc., and hundreds of articles. He has given research guidance for research work for many researchers, scholars, students, including Dr. Ashutosh Vasneya of the Harvard University, Dr. Kony Linenberg of the La Trobe University, Melbourne, Dr. Stefan Lindbergh, Lund University, Sweden, Mike Youngblood, USA, Dr. Gail Ombrecht of the University of California. Personally, I know Sharad for the last 4 years, having been associated with the house of the upper house. I found him to be very forthright in whatever views that he wanted to explain. In fact, there are situations where a bill had to be voted, and if of 245 members, there are views which he had so strong, that is that even if 244 members vote for the bill, I could still be one against the bill and I would vote as the 245th member against. That is a kind of a, he has his own strong conviction about many things. We have discussed over hours sitting in the central hall of the parliament about the various issues, particularly on things like farmer suicide, the low productivity in agriculture, the current institutional framework in which the agricultural activity is being carried out in this country, so on and so forth. He is extraordinary in his insight, and he has a vision for this country which is very unique. And since it reflects the questions which are related to agriculture, which is the livelihood for the majority of the population, I thought we should have the benefit of his presence today. And when I invited him, he was generous enough to accept this invitation and be here with us today. So may I welcome Dr. Sharad Joshi once more to National Institute for Advanced Studies and express my own personal grateful thanks to him for being with us today morning to share his own views. Dr. Sharad Joshi.
Dr. Kasturi Rangan, Sangeeta Menon, and distinguished participants in this training course, at the outset, I would apologize for speaking sitting down. I led myself to be tempted by Kasturi Rangan's invitation to address this training course. His requesting Jaswant Singh was understandable. Jaswant Singh is the leader of opposition. And when he gets an occasion to speak, he can speak generally for 30, 40 minutes and nobody stops the leader of opposition. He gets listened to in rapt attention. I, as a single party member and a single member party, get hardly 5 or 6 minutes. And there are a lot of interruptions because whenever I try to make a significant point, there is roaring opposition from the Congress benches. It really goes to the credit of Dr. Kasturi Rangan that in all this din, he did catch some kind of a spark in whatever I said and did me the honor of inviting me along with Jaswant Singh, who is of course my leader. Later on yesterday, I started regretting having accepted the invitation because Delhi is cold, and I've had a very bad bout of cough, cold and fever, and a whole body ache. And to add to that, P. Chidambaram, the finance minister, fixed today as the date for consultations with the agricultural leaders. I was in two minds whether I should come here and fulfill the commitment to Kasturi Rangan, or should I go to the agricultural consultation. And I made the decision on the basis of two factors. Number one, I treasure Kasturi Rangan's friendship over everything else, number one. Number two, I have attended every pre-budget consultation since the days Dr. Manmohan Singh was finance minister under P.V. Narasimha Rao, and nothing comes out of it. I came here primarily in the belief, not that you will be convinced of what I am saying, because I am myself not fully convinced of what I am going to say. The title that I have given is Metaphysics of Leadership. A farm leader, an agricultural leader, has chosen Metaphysics of Leadership as the subject. Let me start by saying what brought me to this subject. As I said, I have been, even in the Kisan movement, never demanding fulfillment of selfish demands of the farmers. All that we ever demanded was that farmers should have the freedom to dispose of their agricultural produce without any intervention from the government. The farmers would get their legitimate and remunerative prices if only the government did not intervene. So I have stood for freedom of access to markets and freedom of access to technology. These are basically the two objectives of my organization. And I'm glad to say that recently it came out that Shetkari Sanghatna and the Kisan Coordination Committee in India are the only farmer bodies in the world which actually demand abolition of subsidies for the farmers. This is a great distinction. And as a national president of the Swatantra Bharat Paksha, which is successor to Chakravarti Rajgopalachari's Swatantra Party, and this mantle was handed over to me by Minu Masani, I have been facing a problem. Why do markets succeed where planning commissions fail? Very simple. And the mystery has been sought to be resolved by Adam Smith himself by using the word the invisible hand, the forces of supply and demand. There is an operation of the invisible hand which brings about the adjustment. There is some kind of a contribution made recently because of the development in information technology and development of the information technology-based futures markets, where there are offers to sell and proposals for purchase, and they have tried to develop a software which will do the matching. So that invisible hand has been sought to be defined in a more precise manner. The question still remains, why is it that the planning commissions fail? And while seeking answer to this question, I turned a little metaphysical, or turned more little inward, more philosophical, as Sangeeta Menon said, and tried to look into this question. I chose the title, I communicated to Sangeeta Menonji that I will talk on metaphysics of leadership. And then later on, when I started preparing some kind of notes, I realized that I was going to talk more about the physiology of leadership. What is the kind of physiological, physical composition of the leaders? But then, for all phenomena, there are different kind of interpretations, diagnostic methods. As a famous Sanskrit shloka goes, Vaidya vadanti kapapitta rudvikavan jyoti vido grahagatim parivartayanti bhuta bhishengeti bhuta vito vadanti prachina karma balavan munayor vadanti. If you go and consult a Vaidya, he will say that it is because of the kapapitta rud. If you go to an astrologer, he will say the planets are responsible. Then if you go to a panchakshari, he will say you have been affected by some ghosts. And if you go to a Muni, he will say it's because of your deeds of the past births. There can always be different explanations. And in this particular thing, I found that the physiology or the physical inheritance of the people who come out as leaders is very directly linked with the kind of activities they undertake in life. As Kasturi Rangan, of course, brought out, I have some kind of credentials for talking about leadership because I have the rather unusual distinction of doing two things. Number one, there are very few people in India who have created in one lifetime three new institutions. I have created Shetkari Sanghatna when there was no spokesman for the farmers. I created a platform for women's property rights when the women's movement was practically non-existent in 1986 in India. And I am the founder also of Swatantra Bharat Party. And let me say, if not Swatantra Bharat Party, at least the Shetkari Sanghatna and Mahila Agadi are thumping success. So I have some kind of claim on being competent to speak on the question of leadership. What possibly gave me a deeper insight into the problem was the fact that, unlike most leaders in the country, who generally pick up the cause that they fight for from the surrounding that they are brought in, they are born in, I had had nothing to do with my chosen field of activity. George Fernandez became a labor leader because he was born in that kind of a milieu. He didn't actively choose. I became a farm leader, even though nobody in my family has anything to do with agriculture, at least for the 5 generations. I was a lecturer, I was in the IPS, I went to the United Nations Service and came back and became a farmer. It's because my stay in the United Nations brought to my attention the fact that in all developing countries, the capital city is on par with the richest countries in the world. Well, if you leave the capital city and go just about 50 kilometers, then the whole picture changes. And I wanted to find out what it was about, and I came, and I thought that the best way of finding out was to become a farmer oneself. Now, I chose that, which is something that you will find no leader of my knowledge has done. Nehru's are born, of course. There's some are born, some are unknown, some that greatness is thrust. I'm one of those leaders who chose his field. A further distinction, I'm not congratulating myself, but what gives me a particular insight into the problem is, when I came to Maharashtra, I find that there were a couple of people from Mumbai and Maharashtra here. I had worked in French for the 15 earlier years. I hardly was able to speak Marathi. I had no background in agriculture. There had been nobody in my family who had done agriculture. And I'm as a Joshi, I'm supposed to be born in a caste which is generally supposed to be antipathic to the farmers. So I had all the disadvantages for becoming a farm leader. There were many people who told me, how can a Brahmin ever be accepted as a farm leader? And I found I had no difficulty in surmounting that handicap. In fact, there is a newspaper blitz, I think it was, which said that Sharad Joshi was the most unlikely leader of the farm movement. And all the same, I must claim in all modesty that in the last 25 years, I personally have earned more affection from the farm community throughout the country than any other leader who was even born in a farmer's family. That's the kind of background I have. Now, let's turn a little metaphysical. And in all metaphysics, we start with the question, who am I? Is it not? And so I'm looking at Sangeeta because she claimed to be a philosopher. And related to all the other previous information, in the past as also in the future. Now, I am going to make a claim, and this is one of the important tenets of the liberal philosophy of Swatantra Bharat Party, Paksha, that it is the distinction and prerogative of an individual to have this apparatus of perception, classification, storage, and relation. And nobody else has got it. If 4 persons come together and they try to decide amongst themselves a common program of the interest of all of us, then the decision is necessarily going to be false and wrong. This is not something new in economics. It's called the Arrow's theorem, that collective decision making is impossible. The individual perceptions and individual's prerogatives do not lend themselves to algebraical treatment. You can't add them, you can't compare them, and therefore, combination of individual perceptions is not possible. I know, for example, the famous example I give in the farmers' meetings, I can give to the senior executives, of course, that a boy staying in the hostel has to allocate the pocket money that he gets between food and films, and going to films, as he says, 2 simple examples. Now, depending upon the point of saturation and diminishing returns that particular boy has in seeing films or eating, he is able to make, because that's his innate quality, innate capacity. He is able to make a decision for himself. When five of his friends come together and try to decide what they all should do, then that kind of a decision would necessarily be erroneous, because you will be imposing something common on people with different saturation points of film going or food consumption. The conclusion is that collective decision makings are by their very nature erroneous. And that's of course one of the reasons why the, as Dr. Hayek said, planning commissions go wrong. Because planning commissions don't deal with, don't have the perception machinery. They deal with statistical tables. They deal with they deal with figures and reports, etc. But the actual feel of the problem involved, which permits decision making, is given only to the individual. Now I come back to a little, which is a point which I have not well digested. Sangeeta might be able to help us out. That is, that tradition comes from Vedanta, which says that there is a commonality between what, between this particular capacity or mechanism of perception, accumulation, relation, etc., with the consciousness of the entire physical cosmic world as a whole. I have not gone into that. I am not even going to insist on that. But there is a good kind of hypothesis. In more easily understandable terms, the bhakti cult and some Sufi saints, as also Kabir has said it, Teri karma kahani, tera atma bhi jane, paramatma bhi jane. What you know, the God is supposed to know. I am not an atheist. All the same, I am saying that there is a general, there is an identity, there is an individual identity in the Pinda, and there is a cosmic identity in the Brahma, which are there where the perception, as far as you are concerned, is common. Now these two identities, the cosmic and the unitary, are self-established. And all the intermediate identities are necessarily false and necessarily irrational. Now what I am trying to say is, what I am going to put before you is, that the leadership qualities, or leadership generally, springs up by people creating for their own personal aggrandizement intermediate identities which do not really exist, which have no place at all, which are necessarily irrational. For example, a hostel rowdy who tries to gather the four or five people and say, why do you want to listen? Why do you want to make a decision for yourself? Let's gather together, let's take a common decision, and we'll all go to and see the film because that's more enjoyable. Or let's eat food, let's all go and eat the food together because that's more enjoyable. Now what he's trying to do is create a community of interest, create an identity which really doesn't exist. I think that essentially is the source of the attributes of leadership. At a more physical level, this comes from the fact, as I said, individuals have this capacity to perceive, individuals have the capacity to relate, etc. Now generally, man has been given in evolution enough brain power to meet only these purposes. Unfortunately, what happens is, it's not these extraordinarily endowed children who become leaders. As you are all executives, and if you are working under a feeling that all leaders are great people and you have only to be carrying out the orders, I want to create in your mind the basic distrust about all these leaders. The leaders come more out of the fact that they have certain physical incapacities to carry out their normal day-to-day life. The common man who is happy with his children, keeping his wife happy, keeping her husband happy, ensuring that the children do well, etc., they are quite satisfied with it. Now this champ, because of a certain incapacity, I am particular about that, because of a certain incapacity, finds that he has spare brain power and he can use some of his energies for doing work other than what an individual is supposed to do. And this kind of an aberration, or shall I say perversion, which results in the origin of the leadership. I'm going to support this by a certain number of illustrations. There is one version of Ramayana in which Vasishtha tells certain stories to Rama. And one of the stories is that there is a locust swarm, and their job is to fly from one field to another, go on munching, finish off that field, and then jump into another field and start munching there. Now, as the statistical dispersion would have it, it can happen. I'll come to that a little later. The digestive capacity of one particular locust is rather poor. It's not an asset. For a locust, it's a handicap. But because his digestive capacity is poor, he gets tired of munching all the time. And therefore, at one point, he says, is this all that the life is about? Everybody appears to be busy, only munching and grubbing, etc. Is this all life is about? And one day it so happens that he is so satiated that he can't eat any further. So he flies away and sits on a tree and watches from there all his colleagues munching. And at the same time, the farmer and his sons come and they beat up the rest of the locust swarm, gather them, put them in the pit and burn them. And this locust, who has a weak digestive power, who is sitting on the tree, thinks, look, because I was not physical, because I was thinking of something higher, God himself intervened to save me. Now what has happened is, and then there is a very entertaining episode about how the locust tries to attain certain spiritual magnitude, spiritual heights. Then another story is from a more recent English work of fiction, and that's the story of a Swiss stream, clear water flowing above and lot of pebbles inside on which some moss has gathered. And there is a whole colony of insects, and all that they have to do is, in order to resist the speed of the water, they have to stick onto the moss and remain in the stones. Now, one of the insects again has a weak hand and he finds it extremely painful to be clutching onto the moss all the time. So he starts complaining, is that all the life is about? I would like to give up. And the old people advise him, don't do that, the stream is so fast, you will be knocked against the stones, etc. You will be hurt and you will die. Till a certain time he holds on, but later on when his weak hand can't stand it anymore, he just lets go. And when he lets go, of course, he is smashed against this bank, that bank. And then later on continues to flow with the water. And the ordinary insects who are having a lifetime just clutching onto the moss look at him flowing down and say, look at the Mahatma. He has no worries at all. What I'm trying to say is that very often it is the physical infirmity or certain weakness in a man which gives him the surplus required to become a leader. For example, a child who is healthy and who is well fed has the appearance of an indolent child. He doesn't like to budge about too much. He will occasionally laugh at you, laugh at somebody who stands near him to do pleasure to him, to do the pleasure to the watcher. While a baby which is weak will be going out of his way to please the watcher. You have seen that a number of times. Now, the normal human beings might be accused of being indolent, while the weaknesses generate this kind of a extra energy which generally the leaders use. for creating the, and the modus operandi is very simple. Try to create identities. They may be geographical identities, they may be language identities, they may be caste identities. And when they try to create those identities, they form a group of their own which accept their leadership. Now this is in fact very more vicious than it looks. For example, there is an excellent book on the how certain diseases have affected the history of mankind. Particularly a very important chapter is on the effect of syphilis. Now those who were thinking, those who mentioned for some time back about the how great people were in one generation back, and how is it that the number of great men of the incidence of so-called greatness has become less and less. One explanation may be given by this. A large number of great men, starting from Peter the Great, and I think the medical students know a very outstanding example of the Indian leadership. Those who caught, I mean in those days you couldn't really help it, those who caught syphilis, nobody has talked of gonorrhea, those who caught syphilis, and in those days you didn't have antibiotics. And because you didn't have antibiotics, it certainly over a certain period of time, later on they possibly tried mercury treatment, etc., etc. But it did affect their nerves, their parts in the vital parts in the nerves. And it has said that the over-ambitiousness to do something that a common man must not do, in Peter the Great, and there are a number of other, even the, chap who invaded Delhi?
Nadisha.
They were all cases of secondary effects of syphilis. Now we have of course a great example in India. All the medical students know about that. And but for the fact that in spite of his syphilis he managed to retain the affection of many great Mahatmas, I think Indian history would have been quite different. Now when you are trying to think in terms of individual qualities resulting in a certain greatness, I think that's a wrong search altogether. That is the consequence of what is called the avatar theory. That is, some men are born great, they come with a certain greatness built into them, and they only express it. Or to go further, God himself descends on the earth when appropriate time arises. Vishnu na prithvi pate, that is, all kings are the incarnation of God himself. Our Hanuman, on very birth, tries to jump to the sun in order to catch it. We are essentially believers in the greatness from birth. And if you think that the great are born, they have some great qualities, I have a case made that the great are born, not that they are not born, but they are born not as supermen, but because of defective men, is a defective product which appears to get the necessary energy, necessary ideas. And the modus operandi is always the same. Now, this kind of variation or this kind of being abnormal can come from a different sources. Number one, there is the normal statistical dispersion. There are some people in a population, there will always be people who will be somewhere near the 3 standard deviation limits. And those people, in their own time, would try to justify their position. Now it so happens that if the direction of their dispersion happens to be the trend in history, then they may be recognized later on as the great prophets
of the times to come. That's one thing. Secondly, there is a category of people who will be coming from an entirely different population. That is where, for example, the diaspora has a certain role to play when it comes to leadership. The INR first generation in the United States is definitely coming out to be much brighter than the European, than the Americans who have settled down there. The important point is that the greatness that is greatness is thrown, forced on people by circumstances. And I'll try to illustrate it by very specific experiments we carried out one day. Let's take an inclined plane. We are in an Institute of Science campus, inclined plane. And we pour just a little stream of water from above and mark a number of spots with wet spots on the board. Then we can say when the water is left from above, those spots which get touched by the stream will of course be blown up. And we can say that the larger the spot, the greater the chances of his catching the course of history, that course of water. But in fact, the dimensions of the spot have nothing to do with the fact whether he will come into the course of history or not. It is entirely neutral to that. Those that are in the stream, in the course of the stream, will have the spotlight thrown on them or that water thrown on them. That's entirely an accident, and it has nothing to do with how large the size of that particular thing was. In the conclusion, sir, I would like to give certain more examples. You have all heard of Saint Peter the Great, who traveled from Jerusalem to Rome, and on the way, climbing on a hill, he recorded that he had a visitation from God, and that's something which is very sacrosanct for all the Catholics. Now, some of the physicians who read the account of this visitation came to the conclusion that this was a classic case of epileptic fit, that the so-called visitation of the God was an epileptic fit, and there is a great debate discussion on that. And William James, the famous American philosopher who wrote Varieties of Religious Experiences, made an argument. Let's accept that Saint Peter had epilepsy. What does it matter? All that you are going to say is, all that we are proving is, that epilepsy is a better state of body to have visitation of God. That's all. Now, I think that's a very enlightened kind of view. We have some of the greatness. It's not necessary. The bogey that a healthy mind persists in healthy mind has absolutely no support, evidential support. In fact, you will find that it's the abnormal, even in scientific experiments, sir, the abnormality is more useful to prove a particular point. It is precisely the abnormal people who, I'm not really framing a charge sheet against the leaders. What I'm saying is, they unintentionally help mankind for progressing, but that's not because of any special qualities given to them, that's because of the fact that they are essentially wanting in some of the respect. Now, in this case, I would like to make certain exceptions. Number one, there are leaders who use the existing identities. For example, nation. Nation is an identity. And there are people who join the movement for nationalism, for freedom, etc. And it's very difficult, very questionable sometimes whether they are nationalism or whether the patriotism was not an afterthought. For example, somebody who opposes the Boer uprising in South Africa suddenly turns patriotic in India is a thing difficult to understand. The local leaders who want to create intermediate identities and say sons of the soil must have the priority in employment, the language champions, the caste champions, etc., they are of course trying to develop the developed identities, which are much smaller, and they are the worst of the kind. Those who try to push, at least the popular identities, have something to go in their favor. I think the one category of leaders that you can exempt are the people who are trying to widen the scope of the existing boundaries of the identities or the units of perception. For example, I would say, with certain qualification, I think that today when the nation is the accepted unit of identity, any leader who tries to go beyond this and create a larger identity, for example, it may not necessarily be a WTO, it may not necessarily be globalization, it can also be a multinational corporation. But those who try to create a larger identity are leaders who can be said to be foreseeing and prophets of things to come. I will try to summarize. I think my time is over, is it? No.
Yeah. Okay, they can interact with you.
Very briefly, the leaders are born not because they have some kind of a spark of greatness in them. They are generally defective people who, on account of their defect, find that they have spare capacity, intellectual capacity, and therefore use it for fostering unnatural identities. The only two natural identities being an individual and the cosmos. Those who try to create identities in between them, particularly identities that are lower than the current ongoing common identities, are the leaders. And the mankind had better beware of the leaders. The last point, there's a training course for senior executives. Executives are supposed to be limbs of the leaders. And I don't know why the organizers here thought of having this subject. This might actually make your things more difficult in the life to come. Because if you go away from here, thinking that the captains of industry are really... No, industry is yet another exception. No, I forgot to mention two exceptions. I made only one exception of people who form larger identities. Two more exceptions. Organizations which work entirely on compassion, and organizations which work on knowledge, or organizing knowledge. These are the exceptions. But otherwise you'll find, because they don't create the kind of identities that are created in the political field. But otherwise, these leaders are something that humanity we better beware of. Thank you, sir.
Well, why don't you? Maybe I can just say,
Mr. Sharad Joshi really has tried to give his point of view with regard to leadership, but there is an enormous amount of experience that he carries with him in organizing the various institutions in this country. And humbly, he has not really highlighted those aspects of the challenges he faced in organizing those systems, which have really been recognized in the country as very significant.
but not only in the area of agriculture, but many other areas. So maybe you could take this opportunity also to probe his mind with respect to areas like agriculture, institutional building, organizational structures and other things, where I'm sure that he's very competent to comment on because of his own personal experience.
Well, we have 30 minutes and we could take questions. Perhaps questions which are brief and more precise will help for more better clear answers. Let's start.
I'll take Kasturi Gangan's question first.
No, I just made a comment, okay. But okay. Would you like to respond to it?
Yeah. I think one reason of success in the agriculture field was I was a rank outsider, and with the experience I had of administration and the little Poivodan fund I had brought from the United Nations that provided me with certain latitude, I really kept away from political ambitions. The great problem in agriculture was that most political leaders have a personal agenda, and they use farmers' plight only as a pretext or as a kind of masquerade for self-serving for their ambitions. I had no political ambitions at that time, nor not even today. And therefore, I just said what I saw. And when just said what I saw, I found that as usual, problems are not caused automatically. If there are problems, somebody is causing them. I realized it because I was an outsider, and I found that there was a systematic policy followed by Government of India, which is what I've been saying about negative subsidies, of depressing agricultural prices. And that is the main cause of the farmers' indebtedness and also farmers' suicide. This was plain truth, which was not acceptable to the political leaders and not even to the economists of that time, of 1980s. And I said all economists disagreed, all politicians heaped abuse on me, but the farmers agreed. That's the simple solution. Thank you.
Yeah. Maybe you should introduce yourself. Yeah.
Indra from Department of Atomic Energy. Your wonderful lecture on metaphysics is totally different from what we thought. And two questions in this, which I have a doubt to be cleared, is the collective decision is impossible. You've emphatically said that one. That means in a board meetings and all that, it is just the chairman always comes with an opinion and just takes the opinion of others, but finally he decides his own version and goes away. One. Then physical incapacities, leaders will have physical incapacities. I think they are not leaders, but only they are the great people, I can say, not the leaders. These are the two doubts which I have.
It's saying whether the glass is half full or half empty. Maybe that incapacity to fulfill the life of a common man gives them ideas different from. And therefore, I gave the story of those insects in the stream. Now, whether that particular deformity or defectiveness is not a more favorable condition to attaining so-called higher things, I can't say, because I gave the St. Peter's example. Is an epileptic in a better condition to perceive God than others are? We don't know. These are all imponderables and unanswered questions in history. But the fact remains that economics has to be outside the purview of the government. Institutions of compassion, institutions of knowledge have to be there. And the company boards, of course, have a definite motive. They are separate identities. In fact, I have a feeling that multinational companies are most likely to replace nations as a unit of identity, not WTOs and United Nations. Recently, Kasturi Gangan, I pointed out to you that I said that if the Doha round of negotiations have been blocked, it's a good thing, because that will take us into an era where we will have multilateralism without internationalism. Let's get rid of the governments as negotiating bodies. So it's very likely that your companies will start trading amongst themselves without the intervention of the government. So that's the important role that's being played. And in the list of exceptions that I made, economic bodies, because they have a certain identity, and they have a common motive also. Sometimes the motives are rather mixed, but generally they have a common motive, and therefore what the board chairman says generally goes.
Yes. Maybe should wait for the mic, please.
Sunay Mathre from ICICI Venture. You mentioned about leaderships which go on broadening the identity base, as well as, you know, leadership which probably accentuates differences and narrows the identity base. I'm reminded of one interaction I had with another ex-member of parliament, Ghanikant Chaudhary. And we were asking him, we were students that time, and we were asking him questions on various aspects, various topics. And this gentleman had the uncanny ability to answer every question with respect to his constituency of Malda. And finally we asked him, you know, so you have been in this field so long, don't you think you should rise above your constituency and talk of a higher identity? And his answer which he gave was, if every member of parliament does his job with respect to his constituency, you know, imagine what the country can be. My question was, you have sort of almost warned against people who are accentuating identity differences and narrowing the identity base. But actually, if a lot of productive work has to happen, one probably requires to focus on identities to get down to grassroots and provide leadership at that level, because at a macro level, it's very easy to provide leadership. It may not necessarily lead to outputs. Your comments on this?
I couldn't agree more. That was specifically the reason why. To get the farmers in Maharashtra out of their caste identity, I tried to create the identity of India versus Bharat, but didn't work. That also I would admit. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Sir, I'm Dr. Krishnan. I'm from Hindustan Latex. I'm very thankful for your very irreverent speech, which I think contains a lot of meanings at another level. I believe that more than anything else, the defective or the faulty organizational system which breeds defective or faulty leaders. In fact, this stems from the fact that our system of governance or systems which are based on populism, whether it is democracy or even monarchy, all this has certain inherent problems associated with it. If we can have an elitistic anarchy where everybody knows what he must do, probably this situation can be warded off. What are your comments on that, sir?
Anarchy is a word which has taken a lot of odium. I wouldn't call it anarchy. It's the people who created false identities, who had tried to create a bogey of anarchy, as if their particular identity and their particular form of government didn't come in, then there will be chaos. After me, the chaos. I don't think that was only a scaremongering bogey created. The things work actually much better. My experience shows that rather than having a single party government, the coalitions work better. And the unstable governments work better than the stable ones. That's the experience in India. The suggestion that could come forward is, there has to be some kind of a better understanding of the political theory. In our political theory, if the president is indirectly elected, then his powers are bound to be less than the powers of a prime minister who is directly elected. We should accept similarly that any franchise, any election which takes place on the basis of one man, one vote, should be limited only to areas where all men are equal. And those areas are law and order and defense. That's the legitimate function, the legitimate mandate of the government. But anybody who gets elected on the basis of one man, one vote, if he is given the authority to decide where a university should be established, what should be the curriculum for any training course, etc., that's going to result in parvasham. So therefore, in an ideal system, it's not an anarchy. If I attack the government, it's not that I want a government, governmentless body. All that I want is that the kind of all open adult franchise election should give authority only in this area. And if after that, that government is found to be capable of handling more problems, the application for giving them more authority can be considered. But any government which has not succeeded in creating a complete law and order situation should not have a mandate in any other area. That's a kind of modification that's necessary in the political understanding. I would like to say, there was one question asked to Mr. Jaswant Singh. I am taking that question as given to me about the source of corruption. I think we have not Lord Acton's dictum. Power corrupts. No leader will admit that. They will quote Acton. But the fact remains that every leader has a vested interest in creating power centers from where corruption can take place. As Dr. Kasturirangan mentioned in my introduction, I am determined to fight against the license permit quota system. Just abolish them and the corruption will go away. But everybody has a vested interest in corruption. That's the kind of political institution that we will.
Sir, I'm KP Singh from Ministry of Defense. And I basically belong to farmer community. And to tell my background, that I studied up to 10th standard, and I studied barefooted. I'm from that kind of community, coming from a very remote village. When I go back to my village now, when I'm doing a scientific work, I find this lack of leadership for the farmers. And I'm not taking your example, and I'm coming from Western UP, and I can tell example of, like, you maybe heard of Mr. Tickett. Okay, he's leader, but the leadership what he provided to farmers, Kisan unions, and lot of disorders, they can capture any department, say for your transformer is burnt, and they will basically hijack the assistant engineers. Those kind of things really started this kind of. So I felt that lack of leaders for the farmers which can guide them properly. Do you feel there is a lack of leaders which can really guide the farmers really properly, and so they can get benefit of what you call either cost and product or whatever that actually. So according to me, I feel there is a lack of leadership for the farmers in the country in general.
In case of agriculture, I would say there is no lack of leadership. There are too many leaders. That is the problem. Okay. When you use a qualitative term, then there is always a scope for discussion. But for example, I have interacted very closely with Tikayat. And even in the days when I was trying to argue for the abolition of negative subsidies, Tikayat used to say that the formula for the development of agriculture and farmers is 1 gram of political, 1 gram of courage, two grams of morality, etc. So you have heard possibly those people. He was never a farm leader. He knows nothing about agriculture. He was essentially a jat leader, a chaudhari by anointment, by birth, and therefore people consider generally that following the instructions of the 84 village leader was their incumbent duty. He was never a farm leader. It's the mistake of the press that they made him a farm leader. He was essentially a jat leader, and he had for his models Chaudhary Charan Singh, etc. It's a pity, because whenever the agricultural organization appeared to come to some kind of a shape, there is always some kind of a evil spirit like Tikait that comes in. And he was absolutely on provocation by Devilal. You know, he attacked a Kisan Valley in Delhi. So it's not, that shows very clearly that people who talk of farmers' interest might have actually different agenda to serve. Tikait is a very good example of how vicious the leadership can be.
Your views on leadership are really excellent because these are based on ground realities and not exactly belonging to the farming community. You are a farm leader, and that's
can you hold your mic?
That's really
just hold it.
Let's
okay. Hello.
Yeah.
Now, my question is, do you finally conclude that a leader can be more effective and great only if he is emerging out of situation? And number two is, what happens to a leadership like Mahendra Singh Tikait becoming political after a period of time?
All kinds of leaderships are thrown up. And they will survive for some time. Even Shiva Sena has prospered for some time in Maharashtra. But they don't last long. Gandhi stood for the national independence. And now the question that is often posed is, would we not have been better off if we had accepted 1935 reforms and accepted the dominion status? What's the difference between India's present situation and the dominion status? We are part of the Commonwealth. And had we done that, we would not have had Pakistan. Now, whether the decisions taken by that kind of leadership were enlightened enough, at least in hindsight, you never know. All these decisions would be made by history, who was right and who was wrong. And the history is written by those who succeed. And therefore, even the ultimate truth would be only known to the second identity, and that's the cosmic identity.
Sir, how do you differentiate between heroes and leaders? Because the person emerging leader of a situation can be a hero. He can lead for some time and disappear.
Yeah. Well, since you asked me the question, I'm told of another, reminded of another story of a potter's son. Very poor potter and his son, and he was a very lazy fellow. And therefore, one day his father beats him up and puts him outside the door, where he falls, and with all the pot pieces thrown around, he gets a number of injuries on the head, which marks remain. Then one day he is driven out of his house by his father, and he continues to go out ultimately. And at one point, he suddenly sees two armies coming to war with each other. He gets so frightened that he climbs a tree and sits on a branch and continues to watch the warfare for some time. As it happens, the Senapati, the general of one army, he dies, and the horse continues to run. And the horse happens to run from under the tree where the boy is sitting. And he trembles so much that the branch shakes, and he falls right on top of the horse. And the king gets an impression that somebody who has got so many marks on his head of injury must be a very great hero, and he is made a general. So sometimes the heroship, that kind of heroic activity, is surely a matter of accident. Another point would be, a ship is about to leave the port and everybody is waving goodbyes, etc., when suddenly everybody sees that a girl has fallen in the water. And everybody only shouts, to always jump in somebody and save her. Nobody does. Ultimately, they find one young man going down, picking her up and bringing her out, and everybody is patting on his back, saying, "Oh, what a great fellow you are." And he said, "But tell me who pushed me in." I am trying to be, I am deliberately being a little cynical, but with the result that I know that in all these 7 days that you are going to be here, there is going to be so much glorification of leadership that I better provide the antithesis. I better provide an inoculation right to begin with.
A small question, not on metaphysics, on your Shetkarya Sangatana. You have started Shetkarya Sangatana 25 years back, and you have become very popular, and you have become a member of parliament also. What about the flight of the farmers in Maharashtra? Still they are committing suicides in Marathwada. But Western Maharashtra don't need Sharad A Joshi because it's a fertile land and they have a lot of water. And what people are doing, Shetkari leaders are doing to the farmers? Please.
I can't say that Western Maharashtra doesn't need Sharad A Joshi because Sharad A Joshi sprang up in Western Maharashtra for onion. And the sugarcane agitation started in Western Maharashtra and Nashik. And then spread to even Kolhapur and Sangli, and the agitation that are happening there for sugarcane prices are still under the banner of Shetkari Sangatna. The important thing is that the Shetkari Sangatna, because it wanted to remain away from politics, did not try to seize the sugar factories. The sugar factories remained with the opposition, with the Congress, and they continued to have the deciding power with them, which was possibly the mistake that we made. But then it's very difficult to say whether that kind of capturing of power could be done even by Sharad Pawar, because the Congress had the power in Delhi and in Maharashtra, and therefore they could cut cooperatives, or whether they had the powers of the cooperatives and therefore they caught state and then the center. It's a very difficult thing to say. You never know where to begin. But in case of Sharad Pawar, what happened is that right after the independence, the power in the center was with the Congress, and they created a hegemonical situation. And the greatest contribution of Shetkari Sangatna in Maharashtra is that Congress has been, its basis has been uprooted in Maharashtra. That's an important. Secondly, the thesis that we gave, that the poverty of the farmers was essentially a direct consequence of the price policies followed by the government, has stuck. Now, no, all the parties in their manifesto talk of remunerative prices, which they never did before. No, what is done to the farmers is done by the government, isn't it? We play the role not of the government, but we play the role of organizing farmers. What happens in between is
organizing farmers for the leader's sake or for the farmer's sake? That's
one. What kind of following you have is the important question. We don't. The Shetkari Sangatna following is essentially of farmers who want to live as farmers. In self-respect, they have no ambition to become a director of sugar factory. They have no ambition to become an MLA or MP. They want to live in self-respect doing agriculture. That's the kind of constituency we try to serve.
Bimlendra Jha from Tata Steel. I think sit down to be at your eye contact level. Sir, I have some opposite points of view, and I would like to express that on two significant aspects. One is that you said that between the pind and the brahm, everything else is falsity. By that definition, even pind and the brahm have to be falsity, because there is no... One can only be concluded from the other, and therefore, both of them are the construct of our own mind's imagination. And there is a whole philosophy of Buddhism which starts with the doctrine of anatta, which does away with the whole philosophy of pind. But what I personally believe in is that you start from any one side and all the constructs actually help you to evolve towards the other. And therefore, they are not only not false, they are the ones that are absolutely essential, cause and effect relationships, which result in the reality that we perceive. So saying that everything in between is false is also denying our own existence and entire argument actually falls through thereafter. So I would beg to disagree with you on that everything in between is false. Although even great leaders like Shankara have talked about Brahman, Satyam, Jagat, Mithya and things like that. I don't want to get into that. But the more important disagreement that I have is that of the, you know, the lens that you have used to define leadership. As you said, that it all depends upon the lens that a person uses. It could be an astrologer defining it by stars and things like that. And you have used a lens. While it is definitely a very good inoculation and for the coming 6 days, where one can really watch out that is it really situational leadership that we are talking about, or we are talking about transformational leadership. I completely agree with you that there is a lot of situational leadership that exists. And that situational leadership emerges out of the situation a person finds himself into. It may come out of a deficiency or an opportunity. But I would use your own exceptions to prove that there is a preponderance of transformational leadership, which is an act of commission, which is a volition, act of volition, out of which people seek to transform themselves and the society around them. And it is by no means an exception. It is more of a rule. And it is that leadership that we are really concerned here with. If there is somebody born with certain traits and he becomes a leader, it's a different matter. But what we are really concerned over here is, we believe that there is a possibility to inculcate in ourselves something that can really transform not only our own lives, but the lives of all the people around us. And that is the transformational leadership that I would like to really focus our attention on. And would like to have your comments on this, that how come, if all leadership is only situational the way you have described, how come we can ever dream of improving the society?
The society improves on account of the free interaction between the individuals who have got the capacity for perception, relation, etc., etc. The identities that are built by the leaders are essentially used for postponing or defeating the right direction of progress. The quotation here I could give, I don't have the book here, but the Frédéric Bastiat, the French economist, he has given excellent examples of how the state was deliberately used to bring in protectionism. Most of the states are protectionist. And there are a number of other examples where you will find that the state is used deliberately as an instrument of favoring one community in the society as against the other. The most definitive proof of this is given in Ashok Mitra's The Terms of Trade and Class Relations. It actually defines the state as an instrument for favoring one community, terms of trade, turning the terms of trade in favor of one community. Now, it is precisely these identities that are transitional and which won't last long, because the economic interests go against that. The promotional leadership, there is a certain scope, and I define that scope by saying that if you draw a curve of the direction of progress, which is transitional, because in the long run, the direction of history is only towards increasing freedom, increasing degrees of freedom. Everybody who came in the way of increasing freedom has been defeated. And in the short run, if it is a linear curve, then the values, individuals, which are closer to the three standard deviation limits in the direction of the trained, will provide kind of indication as to, will provide a idiom for the kind of change that takes place, and they will be considered as great prophets. The philosophers who are credited with French Revolution really had nothing to do with French Revolution. Then most important philosophical point that you raised is what happens between the individual ego, the pinda and the brahmanda. And I think that comes particularly in Madhvacharya, etc., in the Vishishtadvaita, because of the certain incapacity to understand the phenomenon of the infinite. The individual consciousness or the parameter in the linear programming equations that are required for the decision making are the a certain individual capacity. This linear, the last equation, the n plus 1 equation, is essentially from the capacity of an individual to take I versus the rest of the world. That's essentially you. What is it? I look at the whole world as I being on one side and the world being on the other side. And the capacity of many philosophers to grasp how this would work at the cosmic level. Because the cosmos, beyond the cosmos, there is nothing. And if there is nothing beyond the cosmos, then there cannot be I versus the rest situation at all. The fact is that at infinity, whether you take anything out of it or you add anything to it, remains infinity. And therefore, there is an inversion at infinity. Inversion at infinity, where at cosmos you can have a consciousness without having a I versus the rest of the world attitude. The good example was given by Bertrand Russell in his Paradox of Tristram Shandy. Tristram Shandy, if many people in my generation used to read that novel, is a person who is very keen on giving detailed and graphic descriptions of everything that happens. And he starts writing his autobiography. And it takes 1 year to write one day's account. And the question that is asked is, given infinite life, will he ever complete his autobiography? The question is, at no finite time will he ever be able to complete, but at infinite he will be able to complete it, because there is what is what Bertrand Russell calls the inversion at infinity. At infinity, everything becomes equal, and therefore, the laws that are applicable at the finite will have to be understood with an inversion at cosmic level. That will solve the problem.
Okay. There is a last question.
Sir, it's very interesting that you have brought out. My name is Raghunath. I'm an associate director in Defense Research Lab in Bangalore. Sir, you have brought out very interesting aspect for the leadership. We are from technical side. So for us, always leadership means there is a set methodology where some sort of a training, they can always try to become a leader. The organization can always nurture leaders. This is what we believe. And then now this entirely different sort of an idea you have opened up. And especially this where you say that inability start, is a sort of a starting point for a leader. But is it essential or that is one of the thing, yes. Inability in a person need not be a disadvantage for him to become leader. That means, in other words, people who are strong in their scientific thinking, ability, can always look forward to become a leader in order to sort of give benefit to the community or to the nation.
Only farmers are exploiting. I never said that. Everybody who causes multiplication is exploiting. Animals were the first to be exploited. Women were exploited because they multiply. And the farmers are exploited because they multiply. But the next stage of exploitation will happen at the level of innovators and scientists. And there is a whole community of so-called leaders whose single-minded pursuit is to appropriate the fruit of the innovation of the scientists. So you have to be particularly wary. I mean, there are great innovations, great scientific discoveries and inventions, but their names hardly ever figure except in scientific journals. While the the leaders who become popular are the ones who teach that the intellectual property right should not become a monopoly. They should become common. There is a, in Ayn Rand's Atlas Shrugged, you'll find that all these common men have a great jealousy for the innovators and the inspired, and the, those with imagination. And they dislike the idea of the innovators claiming any credit for that. That should become public property. That's the essential thing. So you have to be a particular reason to be wary of leaders.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Joshiji, for that excellent and very inspiring lecture. And that
I did my job of inoculating.
And which also begins this course.
Thank you so
much. May I now invite Mrs. Usha Lakshmanan, who is the Vice President and Head Insurance Solution Center, Tata Consultancy. So this is for a formal vote of thanks.
Okay.
I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Honorable Mr. Sharad Joshi for giving us this inoculation. And I think this is a very good beginner to this session on excellence in leadership. Ideally, this is what we're going to experience over the next 6 days are multiple perspectives. So we've started with a very good inoculation perspective. And thank you, sir. Thank you for all your inputs.